Oh yeah.
Welcome world, welcome world. Episode 76 of the Great American Hip Hop Today Podcast. If you love hip hop, clap your hands one time.
Lady.
Happy birthday, hip hop.
Shout out to Segway.
DJ Cool Herc. For you to whip
the giant. So that'll be a miracle whip. So everybody crowd around. AG. And let's all get down to the soul clap sound. So pump your fist, here we go. Show biz and AG, so act like you know. A combination of the new and the old rap.
Shit. Me show biz and Diamond D. Yeah, we got the
soul clap. Happy birthday, hip hop. 48 years of existence to culture.
That's right.
That birthed us and raised us all.
Yeah.
Yes, baby.
So clap for hip hop one time. I am the brother Burnz, as always. Episode 76 of the Great American Hip Hop Debate Podcast.
Damn.
To the left, I got the brother VS.
You know it. VS to the OPLBE. You know how it be.
Okay. On the check-in, we got International Blood.
Still reporting live from the injured list, but we here. Let's go.
Is there a disabled list?
He's on it. He's on it.
And checking in live from Texas, we got the homie, singer-songwriter, funny dude, comedian, multi-instrumental player. His bio says dark pop artist, and we're going to get into that because dark pop, I could fuck with that for some reason.
Word.
We got the homie, the king, Exel in the building.
Yo, thank you for having me. I appreciate this.
Nah, no problem, brother. Thank you for being on the show today, bro.
Word up.
Exel, originally from the east, from Pennsylvania, now relocated down south, probably adjusting to the climate change. Not only, you know, heat, but like political climate and
cultural,
racial yep. climate.
Yes. Yes, sir. No, for real. Yes, sir. Yeah. I mean, I'll tell you what, as far as the climate goes with temperature, I got to say I do like the heat a lot more than I like the cold. For sure. You know, so it's definitely a little bit nicer to be able to go outside and not be freezing.
Right.
But then again, my air conditioner just stopped working in my car, so we're going to have a problem here for a little bit.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
It's 107 today?
Yeah, it's 107.
Damn.
So that means it's like 207 in your
Damn.
Car.
Oh, man. But we're going to get to that.
For real.
We're going to get
For
into
real.
Your into your career as a singer, as a songwriter. I want to talk the song Good. I want to talk the song Orange. Then I want to talk about your videos and your skits. We're going to get into all that stuff. I think you're a funny dude.
Wow.
Everybody, make sure you're following Exel on all the socials. That's at Exel the King. Exel the King. Make sure you're following him on Instagram. Make sure you subscribe on YouTube. Check out his videos. As always, make sure you're following the podcast at GAHHD_podcast. Subscribe to the YouTube. Follow the Gram. Follow the Twitter.
The gods.
Make sure you're following Brother F. That's at EFNR711. Shout out Straight Fuego Studios. Hit him up if you need studio time, if you need to record a video. Matter of fact, he's on his Hype Williams shit, so definitely hit him up for that.
Get that crystal clear quality for your earlobe penetration.
Make sure you're following the co-host VSOP. That's at @_VSOP. That's a Twitter exclusive, so if you're not on the tweet streets, you're not going to see that. Make sure you're following the brother Bloodshot. That's at @deadass_worldwide. Set him to get well soon. Card or some Ben Gay or what's the
Shout
shit?
Out to boy.
Send
what's
him a new
the
leg.
Shit that that mom used to rub on whatever? You'd be like, Mom, I broke my leg. She'd be like, no, let me rub this shit on.
What the hell was it?
The Damn, Vicks. The Vapo.
Yeah, the Vapor Rub, yeah.
Vicks Vapor
Rub.
Hell yeah.
Vapor Rub.
But Mom, my bone is popping out of my skin. Don't worry, just put this
don't
on
worry,
there. It'll be
this
all right.
Heals everything.
Yeah. Get some Vapor Rub and ginger ale.
Hey,
Vapor Rub and
go.
Ginger ale. You'll
Vic
be fine.
Ginger ale cures all, bro. Shout out to all the moms out there that kept us safe
on the
and alive.
Right now.
Hey, you rub ginger ale on your broken Achilles, nigga?
I'm rubbing ginger ale and drinking Vicks and shit. The opposite.
Get well soon.
2021 and forever. 2021 and forever.
That's right.
For real. Thanks. Get well soon to the brother Blood. Make sure you're following at call me underscore Joseph underscore. Excellent. And a couple quick shout outs. Shout out to the good people at Raised by Latinos. Make sure you hit them up. Make sure you hit up their website. Get the new merch. I'm pretty sure they're dropping a new capsule soon. Make sure you're following the brother Mesa. At Mr. 100 Sorries. Excuse me. Summers. At Mr. 100 Summers. He just dropped these new shirts, as you can see. He blessed the God with one. Make sure you're following him. Yeah, make sure you're following our super chef homeboy at make sure you're following super chef Petey Martinez the digital food truck. He just premiered some mini steak sandwich pan con bistec sliders. Damn, them shits look crazy good.
Sounds nuts.
Make sure you're following the homeboy Sammy at timeless underscore product. He got a lot of fucking fly designer gear, a lot of fly designer jewelry. Make sure y'all get up on that. Make sure you're following the brother at neighborhood underscore white Mike RB. He will be up here soon. He just recently put together a basketball league in Newark so that different neighborhoods could play each other.
Oh, that's
instead of like beefing and having block wars, they make a team. They represent their hood.
And they beef on the court.
And they beef on the basketball court. He got the mayor's backing. Mayor
Ross Baraka.
Ross, I was going to say Barack Ojama.
What?
You're a Barack Ojama.
Whoa.
He got the mayor's backing. Ross Baraka.
Ross Baraka. Shouts to Ross Baraka.
Barack Ojama.
He been out there.
That sounds like a basketball player hybrid.
Yo, that's the dope basketball player alias, Barack Ojama. But no, the mayor, what's his name?
Ross Baraka.
Ross Baraka. He actually has the MVP trophy. So it's the Ross Baraka MVP trophy for the Summer League. The brother White Mike. He actually, you should know him. He was a fellow MTK resident.
I'm trying to think, Mike.
But anyway, he's going to be up here soon to talk the league and stuff. So shout out to him. Make sure you're following him. Special happy birthday and shout out to the brother YP, Young Paul. Mm-hmm. Make sure you're following him at YP Music Live. Cool. And also special happy birthday shout out and happy birthday and shout out to the homegirl at Boricua 510 and her baby girl Bailey. Both their birthdays on the same day. Shout out to them. And as I said earlier, happy birthday to hip hop, the culture.
Right, 48.
Many blessings.
Where would we be without?
So what's hip hop? A Leo? A Virgo? What's hip hop? Leo?
Hip hop right now? What's right now?
Oh no. Oh, you're getting into astrology now. Oh no.
Leo's a fucked up.
I think hip hop is a Leo.
Nah. Nah, we're crazy.
I got a lot of Leos in my family. They no joke.
No.
I think we're Leo right now.
Oh no, yeah, you're right. You're right.
Virgo is coming up now. Next week.
Shout out to my bad Walter.
All the Virgos out there. Shout out to all the Libras.
Mucho, mucho amor for my people.
Walter Mercado over here with the horoscope reading.
Isn't me, bro.
Y'all seen that documentary? On him?
The one on Netflix, right? Yeah. I haven't seen it yet.
No, I haven't seen it either. I saw it, man.
That shit took me back. No, but you got to watch it, man, because even if you weren't big on him, it takes you back to when you were in, like, Abuela's kitchen or Mom Dude's kitchen, and, like, he would come on. It's just, like, very
nostalgic.
What's the word? Nostalgic. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah.
Well, everybody, make sure y'all check that out. R.I.P. to him as well, and also R.I.P. to the brother Tito Puente. Just because I was watching Salsa last night. I don't know if y'all remember this old ass movie called Salsa.
Salsa.
So I have my daughter in town. Shout out to her. She's in the other room right now.
Shout out.
And I've been putting her onto all the classics, right?
Mm.
So we watched Bronx Tale.
Okay. Did she like that one?
She did. Goodfellas.
Did she like that one? Because that was long as
fuck.
That was
a good one, yeah. That was good.
That's always a great movie, though. Who doesn't like Goodfellas?
We watched The Last Dragon.
Oh.
She was born with it. And we watched, what the fuck else we don't watch? I don't know. We watched Menace. And we watched Lean On Me.
Damn, yeah. Menace and Lean On Me.
Back
Jesus.
To back, so you can see the
the whole
different
thing.
Of the spectrum.
You're really beating her over the head with these things.
Ninja training, I'm telling you. We got to make up for lost time.
Talk about the agogi.
But we watched Salsa last night. a classic in the M. Burnz household. Shout out to Grandma.
It was our classic in our household as well.
And
we've seen
sister,
that a million times.
And shout out to my cousin Marty. Oh,
she's watching it right now.
You know what's funny about that movie? They don't even dance salsa in the whole movie. It's
Even the music is not real salsa.
You're right.
Like
yeah,
an Americanized version of pop salsa. It's the funniest shit. And the hairdos are. My man got an afro and a mullet at the same time. That's
like a curly mullet, right? Yeah.
Bring that back.
Bring that back.
I'm about to resurrect that one.
Oh no, please don't.
But shout out and rest in peace to Tito Puente. He made an appearance in the movie.
Yeah.
So I always thought that was dope. But anyway. We got
Luna.
The homie Exel in the building, singer, songwriter, comedian, dark pop artist. Exel, explain to me, what is a dark pop artist?
Yeah, so dark pop, I mean, I would say it like this. You know how a lot of the pop music is kind of like summer vibe oriented? Well, this is a little bit more slowed down, a little bit more toned down, and more of a darker atmosphere, you know, kind of. Instead of being in a major scale, you're kind of in a minor scale.
Okay.
And is this something that you're going to be releasing more of?
Yes, I really like this direction. Actually, you know, originally I was going in more of just the overall pop direction.
Right.
But once I linked up with Soft Sword Rich, who had worked with T.I., Ludacris, Post Malone, all these people, once him and I had linked up, and he was like, you know what you'd sound really good on? You sound really good on like more slowed down stuff, more darker stuff. He's like, so let's try that. And so we tried it. And I mean, it just song after song we were writing, you know, because he just had me on this wavelength. So that's definitely something I'm going to keep going forward with.
That's kind of what I've noticed. And I actually told Burnz when he got here is that like Orange and Home Run sound, how could I put it? Brighter, like you said, like happier. And then Good is on a darker scale, like, you know, you just mentioned. You know.
And you know, I think it's really good, no pun intended, I think it's really good for an artist to move forward. You know, I just never thought that my moving forward would be this quick, if that makes sense. You know, because you have these two songs and all of a sudden the third song is such a contrast.
Right.
And exactly. I never really expected that. Mm-hmm. You know, I really never expected that myself. And so I'm sure it caught a lot of people up. I know it caught a lot of people up because a lot of people got a hold of me and they're like, yo, you know, I love this new song, Good, but it's so different from what you were doing. Even though I love it, it's just such a contrast. And it's like, you know what? There's always a new chapter to a book. You know what I mean? There's always a new chapter in a book.
Right.
So it's kind of like you have to move forward. And when I moved forward with this, I just felt really good. And the publicity on this song has been the most publicity I've gotten. So I think a lot of people are really enjoying it.
Really connecting to it, right?
Yeah, you know, and I think that's kind of where we're heading within music too, is kind of this darker sound as opposed to, you know, the very bright and upbeat. And there's always going to be a place. Here's the thing, like, genres never really die. Mm-hmm. They just kind of go away for a little bit.
Right.
So I think where we're going right now, if you kind of look at the landscape of music, is we're going back to more of a darker tone. We're going back to a lot more instrumentation being used too, like a lot more live instrumentation. Guitars are being used mm-hmm. again. And so we're kind of going back into like this 90s era of sound.
Yeah.
Whereas before it was kind of like an 80s era, you know, with like a Weekend, you know, even Post, you know, the 808 sound.
Very synthetic.
The hi-hat. Yeah, exactly. Thank you. And so now we're kind of coming now. Yeah. Synthesizers too. Now we're coming back into a 90s sound, which is a little bit more organic,
right?
But it's also still, you know, very produced.
Yeah.
But the vocals are less messed with, you know what I'm saying? The vocals are more natural. So
yes.
Yeah,
I think as society goes through its changes, its ups and downs, which obviously right now society is in a major downward trend. I think people look for music that is more more almost touching them. You know what I mean?
Mm.
And when the vocals, when you can hear the pain in the vocals, that makes you know the artist is like true to what the fuck they're talking about. And me personally, that'd be the shit that connects me most to a song. When I can genuinely feel mm-hmm. the artist's emotion when they were making that song, whether it be positive or negative, that's what really connects me to the song mm-hmm. and to the artist, because now they're displaying their true mm-hmm. self and their true feelings, you know what I mean? And they're allowing us in.
It's funny that you say that, because to me, I find it easier to connect with somebody that, or easier with a song that has like a, more like a down, because to me it's too easy to fake being happy.
Right, right. You know what I'm saying? But you know what?
Absolutely.
That makes sense. Wow. With what I thought about some of the Exel songs, because I heard them in reverse order. So the first song I heard was good.
Right.
So I when I went back into Orange, now I'm like, oh shit, this is different because it's more upbeat and it sounds happy and it sounds poppy. But if you listen to the lyrics of Orange, it's not all poppy.
Right. Yeah.
There's a line in particular that stood out that the brother Exel says, "Used to eat the tuna cold out the can."
Yeah.
And I was like, oh shit, you know, like
We've all been through that.
If you're listening to the artist, the brother Exel, even on Home Run, that the way you were coming off on Home Run gave me super Little Peep vibes. And I love Little Peep.
Yeah, big Peep.
And Little Peep was like very emotional and very dark. So when I heard Home Run, I was like, oh shit, he got the Little Peep vibe, but it's on the poppy beat.
Mm.
Like, wait till he gets on some shit that fits this. And then on Orange, the same thing. The lyric, you know, the beat is very shiny, very fucking sunny. But the lyrics, you can tell Exel was starting to like to get into where he's heading now, which is himself. And congratulations on the success, because I think you're only going to continue to be more successful now that you're going down the path.
Thank you.
Super fitting for what you're doing, and even with the videos that you put up, brother Exel, with like with the guitar stuff, I think that's an avenue you should also
explore
for sure. Because I think with the dark pop and like going acoustic, oh, you're gonna fucking kill them, bro. People are gonna like.
You know what's funny? I was just gonna say that there's a song that's been resonating with me that it's funny because the artist, I'll be like, man, that artist, I wouldn't really fuck with him, but it's just the whole package put together, and it's that new song, "Rap Star" by Polo G. I don't know if anybody's heard it. It's a very acoustic guitar, and then it got the beat in the background, and it sounds a little bit like what you're talking about, like dark pop. And he's very real with what he says. It's candid. Now, again, I'm more of like a lyricist, so you know, it's not like he's spitting anything I've never heard before, but I can still resonate a little bit with the song, which is, I think, what you're doing on Good, you know, on that song Good. And you even start off by saying, "On the side of the road, my life out of control," and I'm like, okay, already, like, he's already being a hundo with what he's gonna spit on this song. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
So I agree with Burnz. You playing the acoustic guitar, and then, you know, with a beat in the background, that'll be a dope avenue to explore.
For sure.
No, I really appreciate it, and thank you all so much for blessing me with those words. I really do appreciate it.
No, definitely, bro. Thank you for doing the music Justice. The right way, you know what I mean? Yeah. And shout out to Sauce Lord Rich. I think you guys together are gonna do some great stuff, man.
Yeah, it's a good combo right there.
Do you guys have anything like in the pipeline set to go, set to release, or are you working on any specific projects?
Oh man, so I mean, literally the last time that we met up, we had tons of ideas, tons of tracks saved up. You know, so there's a lot right now in the vault that we just have to kind of tweak. But I mean, you know, it's all really, really on that path of Good. It's all really that dark pop and everything. And I have never worked with such a professional like that in my life. You think it's kind of like, you think you're good at baseball until you go against Derek Jeter.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
And so
here we are in this room when we had first met. And I'll kind of give the whole story. So what had happened was, I had an alternative band, a rock band in Pennsylvania, and we were doing pretty well. You know, we were kind of getting some traction and everything. Well, then the band broke up and it was like, shit, all right, now I have to kind of recollaborate. I didn't do much with music. And then I had a friend of mine tell me, he's like, yo, you ever hear of Post Malone? At the time, I didn't really listen to Post Malone. If I listened to anything hip hop oriented, you know, it was Tupac, it was Big, you know, it was all that kind of stuff. And, so when I had learned about Post Malone, I was like, all right. And he's like, yo, you could sound a lot like him. You know, you could really hit kind of that vocal range, you know, because my friend was like, you're a really good singer, so you should do some covers, kind of get yourself back out there. And so I listened to him, and I went to a friend's house who owned a studio, and we recorded some tracks of those covers. So we recorded some cover tracks and everything. And, you know, I just went on Facebook, and I started hitting up every single group I could find. I was a Post Malone fan group. And so I'm hitting everybody up. and this one page from Brazil ended up sharing it, and they had a million followers. So once they shared the cover of the song is when I went viral. And so I got over a million views on this cover and everything. And then I checked my Instagram one day, and I had all these new followers in terms of producers. So I had Travis Scott's producer follow me. I had Lil Wayne's producer follow me. And then I had Sauce Lord Rich producer follow me. And so I had talked to the other guys, previously, but, you know, I think they were just so busy at the time that we couldn't connect, me and those other producers. Mm-hmm. And so I had talked to Rich, and Rich was just so kind and so, you know, forthcoming and just accepting me and being like, hey, man, you know what? I really believe in you and everything. Why don't we kind of keep talking? Let me send you some tracks back and forth, and I want to hear what you can do with them. And I was like, oh, man, like, what do you want me to do? You want me to go to the studio? You want me to pay for, like, the studio or anything? And he's like, no. He's like, if you record it through your phone, he's like, I just want to see what you can do outside of covering someone's music, you know? And so I had done that. I had sent him some stuff, and he's like, this is dope. Like, I really can't wait to get together. Why don't you meet me in Georgia? Meet me in Atlanta, you know, so-and-so date. And so I had gone down to Georgia from Pennsylvania, and we had just linked up in the studio, and we were there, I believe, 2 weeks. I was in the studio with him, and it was about 16 hours a day we'd work on music. Just 16 hours a day working on music for 2 weeks straight. Ooh. And you know what, though? It never felt like work, because this is somebody who is so intelligent, and a broad spectrum intelligent with everything, but with music, just such a master at that craft that it never felt like work. It was always fun. Right. Everything just felt fun.
And you got to be learning along the way, right?
Oh my God. Yeah. I learned so much, so much. You know, I really felt, it's just such a special memory looking back, because it's like, I'm so blessed to have even had that opportunity. Whereas a lot of people never know the formulas that I found out from such a master at the craft, someone who is 7 times plat, you know, and I'm lucky enough to call him a friend now. So it's just insane. It's really insane.
Yeah, man. God bless.
That's dope.
Damn, I'm happy for you, man. That's dope. Dope experience.
Thank you. Thank you.
Now, when you guys link now, where do you link? In Atlanta?
Yeah, Rich is on a break right now. He's been taking a little bit of a break from music, trying to get himself, you know, where he needs to be. But yeah, that's where we do all of our work, is in Atlanta. We do that. And then sometimes there's also another producer there. His name is Life. He's really dope too. And sometimes I'll just use my studio here in Texas, and I'll just pass him over some vocal tracks.
Okay. And you have a home studio?
Yeah. I mean, it's just a mic and a little tiny setup. It's nothing extravagant at all.
But do you know how to, like, Or not do you know how to. Do you engineer yourself and, like, mix your own vocals at any point?
You know, I do for, like, covers. But as far as my own music, I'm not to any kind of standard that Life is. I'm not to any kind of standard that Rich is. You know, so with that kind of stuff, I just pass them over the stuff, you know, and they take care of that.
And the producer, Life, where is he from?
He's from that area too. He's down there in Atlanta.
Oh, okay. That's awesome. So now when your producers are on break, taking a break from music, what do you do in that time? Do you continue to write? Do you continue to come up with music?
Yeah, I'm constantly writing. I mean, you know what? I just wrote a song, which I sent in that email, by the way, which is just for y'all. It's not out yet.
Oh, awesome. Thank you.
But it's funny. It's funny that, you know, it was saying like, oh man, you know, that dark pop, have a beaten back it with an acoustic guitar and some electric guitar, because that's that track. Like, that's where we went next.
Damn, we definitely got to check that out then.
Okay.
And now, yeah, everything and, that you're recording, is it building up to like an EP or a mixtape? Or is that undecided?
You know what? I get that question a lot. And from what I've learned from everybody that I've been lucky enough to learn from, we are in a very single-driven era with music. I think an EP and an album is good once somebody is big enough to have an EP or album.
Yeah, once you're established.
Back in the day, right. Back in the day, you got big off an EP, or you got big off a record. Now it's you get big off a song, and right. that's it.
Yeah, and again, I think I think that has to go again, like we mentioned before, with people's short attention spans.
Well, good. No, no. Now the conversation is going to take a shift into social media and society today and short attention spans and the constant need to release music where Exel, I don't know your age, brother, and you don't have to reveal it to me, but we're from a little bit of an older generation where the album was the culmination. You know what I mean? Like that was what everyone was waiting for. So you would drop your single and then you would drop your album. And then after that, you may drop another single or two or whatever to work the album. But what everyone waited for was the album. But today, nowadays, you can drop a single, you can drop five singles, six singles, and then drop the album, and the album just be those six singles. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
And it's funny how music has reversed, and I think social media is playing a big part in that.
Yeah.
Absolutely, and you know, go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, I was actually going to ask you, Exel, but you seem to know how to fuck with it, how to fuck with the social media. Because not only are you doing music, you're also doing a lot of skits, a lot of videos for the gram, a lot of TikTok. I see your TikTok activities crazy. I also see your YouTube videos. And they're all different. You're not doing the same shit on every channel. You know what I mean? So is that something that you're studying? Or it's not a mistake. So you know what the fuck you're doing.
I mean, that goes to being a Gemini. I'm bipolar as fuck. but no, I mean, honestly,
my wife is Gemini. What, I know where you're coming from, man. My wife is Gemini.
Yeah, we're fucking crazy.
But let's go one at a time. Let's go one at a time.
Right.
You got the
All
music.
All love to the wife. All right? love to the
yeah,
wife.
Yeah, yeah. Big shout out to the brother Blood's wife.
Okay.
She holds it down.
Both sides.
Yeah, shout out to her.
Both sides.
But let's start with YouTube, right? So the stuff on YouTube, minus the video for good, and shout out to that. That's a good video. But all the other stuff on your YouTube channel is not music related. It's more comedy, satire,
content related.
Right. What made you go that route?
Yeah, so you know what? I really feel like a big thing that's been missing, I think, why a lot of people don't relate hard to an artist is because, I'll be honest, you know, when I had learned everything I learned from everybody, the first thing I was told is music is like professional wrestling. You're a character. And you just better hope people like your character or you're going to be gone pretty quick.
Right. And you got to sell the character.
So for me, I was like, you know what? I feel like I could be myself, but also be a character at the same time. You know, so for me on YouTube, I do more like daily life stuff. So kind of taking everybody through, hey, this is what is going on today. And if you go back like a few months, there was a video where I had first talked about like, yo, I got hit up by, you know, Post Malone's producer. And like now here I am and we're friends. So it's pretty cool for someone to kind of get that introspective see like, whoa, this is cool. You know, seeing him go from here to here and we're all being let in on it because I don't view myself as anything different than what everybody else is. You know what I mean? So for me, it's kind of like someone talking about they got a raise at work. You know, for me, it's kind of like someone saying they got a managerial position. You know, at McDonald's or whatever. Mm-hmm. I think everything's dope. I think that's dope. Yeah, for me, though, my career choice is this, right. You know? And so I kind of like letting everybody know. So the reason for YouTube to kind of get back to that is I feel like more artists need to be real with themselves and need to let people in. So everyone can kind of experience it. You know, you're a TV station that's on 24/7.
Yep, and it's all different channels. So yeah. YouTube is one channel.
All different channels.
Yep. Shout out to the Facebook Marketplace. What was the fucking title? Is weird, I think. Was that the title, Exel? Facebook Marketplace is weird, something like that?
Oh, yo, yeah.
Yo, that's a funny video, brother. Definitely. Is comedy something you've ever thought about?
You know, I was class clown in school, and everyone used to tell me, I'm only 27. I just hit my glow up, right? I just started looking like Jason Momoa. I don't know when the fuck this happened, but it happened hard.
Yo, I forgot to add that to the intro, the son of Roman Reigns.
Bro, for real. What the hell?
Son of Roman Reigns.
But you got to use that. The girls, they love that.
Yeah, man.
I know. Well, this is what I'm saying. So people ask like about comedy and everything. You know why? Because in high school, I was ugly. That's why. That's why I'm funny.
Right.
Because that's what I had to use.
You had to be funny back then.
Yeah, you're human. Word up.
Yeah, exactly. So like now, you know, I can use it and everything and tap into that. But yeah, man, I mean, I've always liked comedy. My brother was always funny. Now my brother's actually 20 years older than me. He helped to raise me. Oh, so, wow. You know, he was kind of right. Giving me, you know, all them dirty jokes and everything when I was like six, you know? Nice. So, you know, I mean, comedy's always been big in my family. My mom's hilarious. My brother's hilarious. You know, it's kind of always just kind of been our thing because honestly, you know, we grew up struggling real hard. So it's kind of like that's what we had. You know what I mean? It was make each other laugh.
Laugh so you don't cry, right?
Yeah. Gotta laugh to keep yourself
exactly.
Crying.
You know? I remember my mom used to say all the time, she'd say, if I had a good day, I'd have a nervous breakdown because I wouldn't know how to handle it.
Mm. Hey, shout out to mom.
Wow. Shout out to mom
for making it through the struggle. And stuff.
Yeah. You know, so I mean, comedy's always been in my heart. You know, and I always just want to make people laugh. If someone's not feeling something through music, I want them to be laughing. You know, I don't want to see anybody crying. I don't want to see anybody hurting because I know we're all in it right now. You know, especially coming out of COVID or possibly going back into COVID.
Yep.
Yeah. You know, it's tough. It's tough. You know, jobs, people losing their jobs. You know, babies getting sick. Grandmother's getting sick. Mm-hmm. Grandfather's getting sick. Mm-hmm. It's tough. It's tough right now. And especially, you know, not to get too political, but especially with the tensions and everything going on, it's real hard. It's real hard, and everyone's feeling it. Everyone's feeling it. You know, so
even the strongest minded individuals are feeling.
That's
it
what I was just gonna
bit,
say. There's definitely, you know, a physical toll that everyone is under right now, or that is taking place on everybody. You know, mm-hmm. since the pandemic happened, like it hasn't ever only been the pandemic.
Right.
Like the pandemic happened, right. Then the riots happened, then the fucking election happened, then the heat wave happened, and fucking Biden, like it's always the pandemic plus some other shit. So
exactly.
And then
random death,
the effects
know what I mean?
Of the pandemic, you know what I mean? Like the brother XL said, the people losing their jobs, the people that are passing away, the mourning, the fact that you can't even bury somebody if they pass right now, like there's so much physical, mental, spiritual stress, emotional stress that everybody's under, and
it's,
you know,
it's like a compound effect.
Yeah, and we're all looking for that outlet and that's something to either take our mind off it or help us cope with it. And I think now XL is a perfect time for you to be doing what you're doing, branching off into all these environment, all these different channels. And, you know, making people laugh or making people look at something like, damn, the Facebook Marketplace is a fucking weird place. Or, damn, I did get played out by the stock or Robinhood, whatever the case may be. You know what I mean? But thank you for recognizing that,
you know,
and for trying to help people, you know?
Oh, of course, you know, because, I mean, Bruce Lee said it best. Under the sky, there's only but one family, and that's the human race. That's it.
Yep.
You know, and so we have to all be, I think the thing is I believe in energy, you know, I believe in energy totally. And our energy here on Earth is so down right now, you know, because everything just piled on us, you know, so you feel it. I remember when the pandemic first happened, you know, I felt it. I woke up and I felt it, you know, you just felt that energy drain.
Yeah. It's
because
like
everybody's
gloom,
like, shit, what
like
do we
gloom
do?
Gloom and doom and shit. Where?
Yeah.
Right. And you know what? Like, it's tough, you know. So I just hope we eventually find a way out, whatever that way out's got to be. You know, I feel like we eventually got to get there because, unfortunately, now because of this new variant, whatever people think, you know, on either side, you know, like I said, I don't want to get political with it. If you get a vaccine, dope. If you don't want a vaccine, hey, I don't know. I can't tell someone what to do. But unfortunately, we're seeing music festivals get shut down again. Tours are getting shut down again.
Mask mandates are coming back.
Absolutely. So, I mean, the thing is that people, some people don't realize exactly where our bank accounts are as artists. Because I posted a thing on my personal Facebook the other day. So I have about 250,000 streams on my music.
Nice. Mm-hmm. Congrats.
My paycheck for that. Thank you. My paycheck for that was $210.
Yep. That sounds appropriate, but that doesn't sound right, that makes sense.
Right, exactly.
Right. You know, so what people don't realize is our money is from merchandise. Our money is from touring. Our money is from shows. Mm-hmm. You know, so we are getting as affected as small businesses, because as an independent artist, you are a small business. You have to be a business person in order to make it in that realm. So, you know, it's unfortunate that we're getting this Delta variant now, and now people are pushing against the system for the vaccine, like saying they don't want the vaccine. But then you have the other side also bashing the side that doesn't want the vaccine. But then you got the people who don't want the vaccine bashing the people who want the vaccine.
Yeah.
So it's like, you know, there's really no winning.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, in order for us to kind of get rid of this, you know, a decent amount of us at least have to get the vaccine, you know, and kind of get this over with.
Yeah. Let me ask you a two-part question. Number one, do you have merch available right now, and where can the people find it?
So right now, we're actually working on some really dope merch right now, and I can't wait to get that out. But everything you'll be able to find on my Instagram page. I'm going to be posting all that stuff very soon. Merch drop is going to come here with this next song drop, which this next song we're looking at probably about a month out. I like to do about a month lead in, you know, with promotion and everything, kind of get that all good.
Yep. Dope. So everybody, check out, make sure you're following at Exel the King, EXEL the King. Be on the lookout for that merch. And the follow-up question was, during this small window where it almost looked like we were getting back to normalcy, and stuff was opening up.
Yeah.
Were you able to do any shows? Were you able to get out there and link with the fans in any capacity?
You know, I got offered a show in Texas, and unfortunately, due to COVID coming back around, you know, that got shut down pretty quick. But as far as linking with fans, I mean, I'm always active. You know, I'm always hitting people up. I have people coming into my DMs and everything, and they just want me to send them like an autograph or something. And to me, that's just amazing.
Yeah,
it's just incredible, you know, because I graduated with like 35 kids, you know, and now I'm the biggest one to come from that school. So that's wild. You know what I mean?
That's awesome.
It's crazy. It's crazy, you know, because I always knew I had to be somebody. I was never the type that I would be able to deal with a 9-to-5 job. I think a lot of people deal with 9-to-5 and they do it very, very well, and more power to them, because I was never that person. I've never been good at a 9-to-5. I'll be honest, you know, because my mind always wandered into music and into other, you know, avenues, creative avenues.
Mm-hmm.
No, but it's good that you recognized that at an early age and didn't waste your time or your talent, you know, pretending to be something that you knew you were not going to be able to be. You know, why waste your time even trying a 9-to-5? You know, yo, that's not for me. I got to go do this creative shit. You know what I mean? There's a lot of people that they'll spend 20 years that 9-to-5 and
facts.
Then try to be like, man, fuck this. Let me
Absolutely.
Try to do this. No, that, congratulations to you for seeing it early and following that path, following your path. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Thank you. And, you know, I really chalk this up to having, well, older parents. My mom currently, you know, she's in her late 60s, and my brother, he's turning 50, you know, and I'm only 27, so I'm still the baby out of everybody.
Right.
And so I chalk that up to that, because my mom is a super talented artist in terms of like drawing and everything.
Cool.
So when she was 19, she had my brother when she was 19, and she was actually seen in some contest for drawing, right? For Hallmark. And so Hallmark Cards was going to pay her full scholarship, because she was raised on a farm, literally a dirt floor, you know, so she had nothing. And So Hallmark was going to pay for her scholarship, you know, go through college. And then she was going to be the head designer at Hallmark. Because at the time, they had actual people, you know, draw the stuff.
Right. This is pre-Photoshop and pre-CAD. iPad and shit. Yeah.
Exactly. So, you know, she was going to make bank. But, you know, she said, I want to take care of my son. You know, and so she took care of my brother and everything. And while she doesn't regret it at all, you know, taking care of my brother, she always told me, she said, don't end up like me. Don't pass it up. Right. When you got the opportunity, just go for it.
God bless her. Imagine how tough that decision must have been. Well, actually, you know, for her, it was an easy decision because she knew what she was going to do. But, you know, any of us placed in that position, I mean,
that's
God bless her. You know what I mean? Sure. And God bless her for giving you that. You know what I mean? Let me touch back real quick. We were on YouTube videos and you mentioned your glow up. Pre-glow up, were you comfortable on camera?
Oh, bro.
Because now you seem very comfortable on camera. You seem you don't mind making fun of yourself. You don't mind laughing. Before the glow up, that was not a thing.
Absolutely not.
But you were still funny, just not recording it or releasing it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, there's probably videos you can find somewhere of me pre-glow up. Doing funny shit because like I've always been an entertainer, you know, so I always wanted to get myself out there, but I would definitely was not comfortable at all. And the glow up actually happened when I was like, I want to say 15, I actually started training for professional wrestling. I was training for real. I was training for professional wrestling.
Where?
And, you know, so this was in Pennsylvania. I don't know if y'all are familiar with Berwick, Pennsylvania.
Nah. No, but I'm very familiar with wrestling. No.
Yeah, word up.
Okay.
Is it anywhere near Bethlehem? Because I know The Rock lived in Bethlehem for a minute.
Oh, but, yeah, the Wild Samoans. I didn't train with them. No, I did not train with them. But my trainer was trained by the Wild Samoans who are related to The Rock.
Dope.
Wow.
Yeah,
okay.
The whole
NY
family.
Yeah.
Right. So,
well, shit, you're a part of that trained. Too. If you're the son of Roman Reigns,
I guess so, bro.
You're in the bloodline,
I'm still waiting
baby.
For that paycheck.
Yeah.
I always joke with everybody. I said if I ever went back to professional wrestling, Vince McMahon would be like, "All right, you're Samoan now. You're a Samoan. Absolutely. You look Samoan. Here, I'll make you Samoan."
Absolutely. Excel, the Samoan.
You know, not knowing that I'm just a Jewish Native American dude. But hey, you know what? If they
wanna... He's gonna sell the character. I'll tell you that.
Hey, you know what? Roman Reigns' cousin comes in and takes the title. I'm there.
There you go. I'll watch that shit.
But yeah, I mean, so I was training there, and what had happened was something went down with the trainer, and the training had stopped. You know, and I never went back to it. Instead, I got really focused into bodybuilding, you know, like Arnold Schwarzenegger, all that kind of stuff.
Right.
And so I started going down that path. Well, then I lost 110 pounds when I was 15. And then I got sponsored by like all these supplement companies and everything.
Wow.
And so I did that for a while. And then, long story short, fitness just kind of became my life. You know what I mean? So that's my huge hobby. Music is my career. Music is my career path. I love it. I would never do anything other than music. But like as my hobby, I like to bodybuild, you know, and really stay on my fitness.
Dope. And you can see the results on the gram for sure. Definitely
your wrestling character, you know, it plays into that whole thing. I can't wait for you to come out with like a mask, like Kane or something like that. You know what I mean?
Oh my God! Yo, Kane is one of the blood.
Remember that? Oh man!
Kane is one of the ghosts, bro. Oh my God!
Yeah. Damn,
he's the man right there.
We're gonna have to connect on.
I remember my brother. I remember he used to choke slam me and shit on the trampoline. I was like,
what?
I was like 10 years old, and here's this. here's this 30-year-old dude choke slamming his little 10-year-old brother on trampoline.
That's all part of the training.
I used to listen, man, I know everybody's done it before. I used to fake cry all the time. I used to be like, you hurt me, like, mom, where's mom?
Shout out to your brother, man. He played a major part in your upbringing and in your life, man. Yeah.
He was my dad. I still view him as a father.
That's dope,
man. Yeah, definitely. Cool. Shout out to him, bro. We were talking off air a little bit about social media and the algorithm. As an artist today, how difficult is it to constantly keep that algorithm jumping? Because it's like you have to post every day. For sure, you have to post every day. That's without a doubt. But you have to post almost sometimes 3 or 4 times a day just to keep your the algorithm's like a heartbeat or something. So you have to keep that shit up. And if you don't post, the shit starts dying down. And then once you do post again, it's only released to a very small amount of people. Build it back up. As an artist, that can't be easy, Brother Exel. Like, do you think about that often? And is it a new pressure on artists?
That's a great question. And the thing is it's very depressing. It's very depressing. You know, sometimes you don't want to do it. Sometimes you don't want to do something. And I know, trust me, I know some of the people are thinking, oh, well, you know, that's a great problem to have. That's the only thing you got to do. You know, I understand. I totally get it. But yeah, I mean, having to be on 24/7, I don't care what any artist says, it's depressing. Because not so much for the privacy, because I don't really care about my privacy. You know, I let people into my life all the time. But as far as having to fake it, if I'm having a bad day, I can't, you know, make a TikTok video and be depressing.
Right.
I can't do that. You know, you can't do that. You need people. Again, we're going back to professional wrestling. You need to be this character 24/7, wherever that character is, you know. And so a lot of artists going in here with the social media, going even deeper, artists wonder. They say, I have this dope music, but why is nobody streaming it? The problem is there's so much music now every single day. What I've learned is you have to give people a reason other than your music to check out your music, if that makes any sense.
Yes, absolutely. You have to draw them in with something, even if it's not the music, even if it's not related to the music. You just have to draw them into your little force field and then slap them with the music.
Yeah, check this out. Well, I got you here.
But that has to take its
toll. Yeah, absolutely. We see that every day.
That has to take its toll on an artist, because now you're having to, like, mask emotions to continue to appeal to people. Mm. And damn, I mean, after a while, that has to be exhausting. And what happens the 3 days that you just get a creative drought? You know what I mean? Like, the algorithm has no mercy on
your creative drought.
Break on your emotions, nothing.
On your feelings.
Absolutely. I try to read up on the gram and their algorithm, and you know, they recommend posting at a specific time every day so that your followers know, like, oh, at 10 o'clock this guy's gonna post something. Mm-hmm. But it's you know, you wanna create, you wanna, let's say you're making music and you fucking forget about the 10 o'clock shit.
Exactly.
Like, and it's a like I stated earlier, it's a newfound pressure, because artists back in the 90s didn't have the pressure on social media. They got to create for a year. Yeah. You know, they got to lock down and create for a year. Nobody saw them. They didn't have to tour. Maybe an interview here and there, or an article in the source or something, just to keep the name buzzing until the rollout came.
Exactly.
But now it's
still, even when the rollout came, they had a whole fucking team of people from the record label doing the rollout.
Absolutely.
You know?
They
had the street team. They had the fucking promoters that would go to the clubs and shit. They would have the people handing out the records and doing the payola and all that dumb shit. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? They had a whole team of people doing that. Now the artist is the team. Like, the artist and the people around him are the team.
Does that apply to you as well, Exel? Are you basically doing most of the work yourself?
For the most part, you know, I do have some promotional help, which, you know, I kind of have a little team put together for promotional help. But I feel we are in the best, worst time for music ever. We are in the easiest time to get discovered. Mm-hmm, but we are also in the hardest time. You know, So the issue is where's this balance? Where's this middle road at? Unfortunately, where we are in music is, you know, you have all of this music, So you got to stick out. And if you stick out, then you have to keep going with that. You have to keep moving further and further and further. You can't just have one dope song and expect your streams to be going crazy for a year, because usually you got about a month and a half, you know, if a song's popping off. So here we are in this time of music where, you know, you used to have the club owners and everything, getting your name out there, and, you know, you're in the source, or you're in Double XL or whatever. And so now today, you literally are not only doing everything yourselves, but now you're not really even that sought after. Because beforehand, why did everybody go to a Michael Jackson show? Just to watch him stand there for 5 minutes while he looked out into the crowd before anything even started. Because no one saw him before he entered that arena.
Shout out to Michael Jackson. Hold that thought for a second, Excel, because damn, when that motherfucker would hit the stage and he would just stand there and people would cheer and faint and cry and cry, die, like, yo, you, I don't know if we'll ever see that again.
I think we did once and probably won't see it ever with Kanye. He emulated that.
Yeah, but I don't know.
No, it's different with Michael Jackson. There's no question. There's
like,
no
if
question.
We watch that video right now, that shit will give us the illest chills, because that motherfucker, like, and he literally just stood there and looked, like, yo, I could picture that shit in my brain, like if
statue.
I was there.
And
the people were going crazy, like Jesus Christ had just resurrected on stage, yo. Shout out and rest in peace to Michael Jackson. Forever the fucking king, bro, for real. Go ahead, XL. I'm sorry, bro. I just had to get you up to the king.
No, for real. And I feel the same way. You know, I really came up on music and everything from Michael Jackson and all that. So I totally feel you. You know, but the reason is because even with everything with Michael aside, right? Everything that had gone on, whatever had gone on. The thing is that he was still out of the public eye 9 times out of 10.
Right. Very enclosed.
So now,
inclusive.
Right. Very, very elusive, you know, very elusive. And so now, you have people on 24/7. So why don't people want to go to a show? Because they already saw you. Mm-hmm. You know, they saw you on Instagram, or they can see the live stream, you know, whatever. Kanye, when he had that listening party, right? Mm-hmm. Yes, don't get me wrong, the arena was filled up, right? The arena was filled up, don't get me wrong. But you know how many people took that live stream and put it up on YouTube?
Right.
You know, exactly. Of course, it don't hurt Kanye at this point. It don't hurt Kanye at this point. Don't get me wrong. You know, don't get that twisted at all. He's fine. But, you know, there's something to be said for the independent artists. So it's like, okay, when you have all these characters, when you have somebody like Kanye, when you got somebody like Travis Scott, when you got somebody like Lady Gaga, Madonna, we could go on. You know, how do you set yourself apart? Where do you fit in this character realm? You know, it's kind of like you're going into WWF and you got to be a better character than The Rock. How are you going to do it?
How do you do that to one of the greatest of all time?
How are you going to do that? And how do you put asses in seats? You know what I mean?
So and maintain them.
You want to give people a
one-time
reason.
Thing.
Right. So, you know, you got these people that are following you all over Instagram or Facebook or whatever, but now give me a reason to come to your show. You know, now give me a reason to come out of my house to see you.
And I think that's another problem that we're having, especially in hip hop, is that's the problem. Everybody's the same. Everybody sounds the same. Everybody looks the same. They're all doing the same fucking fuckery online and shit. You know what I mean? So, like, why would I go? It's like you just said, why would I pay money, first of all, and leave my house when I could see all this shit a million times on any social media platform?
You know what I'm saying? And also,
you have to set yourself apart. Like somebody like The Weeknd. He just kept buzzing. He had like this mystery around him. So,
well, that's a perfect word.
His character.
That's a perfect word. Mystery.
And there's,
when he first came
glow.
Out, right?
Yeah, he wouldn't do interviews. He would never see him.
He played up to that.
Yeah, exactly.
And that created the interest.
Go ahead, Exel. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Right. And no, you're good. And so there's that glow with The Weeknd, right? Because when The Weeknd came out, he just sounded a lot like Michael Jackson. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so now The Weeknd's The Weeknd. You don't think about Michael Jackson, The Weeknd anymore. You think about either Michael Jackson or The Weeknd.
Correct. Yeah.
You know, he carved out that character. However he had to do it, he carved it out. Mm-hmm. You know, and so there's this whole thing is just about, you know, character development. And people miss that oftentimes. And the problem is, though, is when people get too caught up in a character. Look at Tekashi 6ix9ine. You know, look at all these other people who got caught up real bad because they got caught up in a character. Mm-hmm. You know,
like a Pooh Shiesty.
Right. In what I've learned, you know, working with the people that I've learned, is, you know, you can be a character, but never become that character, because that's when problems start.
But isn't it...
That's good advice.
Isn't that very difficult in today's day and age where you have to be the character 24/7? When do you get to turn the character off?
Exactly. And that's kind of rounding out to where we started with this is, I couldn't answer that. You know what I mean? It's kind of like people want that 24/7.
Yeah.
Because it's not at their cost. Does that make any sense?
Right.
You know, it's not at their health. It's not at their safety. Right. Right.
Not at their expense.
I would say when it comes to choices, it's entertainment. Yeah. When it comes to choices, because as you're saying, it's all entertainment. So, for example, 6ix9ine had a choice. Like, he built his character of being a gangster. He didn't really have to be a gangster. He just had to play into the character. The fact that he acted like he was a gangster, which is what got him caught up. Pooh Shiesty, for example. Whoever, you know, it's all in your choices that you make at the end of the day, because you can't be your character 24/7, but you can act like it, you know?
Right.
Yeah, but I don't know. I get what you mean,
but I just think it's difficult because the camera's always on. So you almost have to overact the part to make people believe, you know what I mean? So it's like...
Yeah,
you have to try to be gangster almost in a Tekashi situation.
Of course, but let's say, and I don't mean to cut you off, Exel. Let's say, Exel, you build up this hype as being like a rock and roll type celebrity, right? And you get this opportunity where you can smash in like a cop's car with a TV in front of people. You're not going to do that because of your character. You're going to do it because obviously you're going to make that choice because if that's what you want to do, that's who you are. That's fine. But then you're not going to do it just because, hey, let me do it because the cameras are on and I'm Exel, you know? Because then you make that choice and then you fuck yourself up at the end of the day. You know what I'm saying? I don't know if you know what I'm saying.
I get what you're saying.
I totally understand.
Go ahead, Exel.
You know?
I totally understand. And, you know, I do not know Tekashi. I do not know his people, you know, so I'm not going to speak on that, you know, deeply. But if that is what it is, if Tekashi is playing a character, because I have no idea, you know, but let's just say with the whole character situation, when you get to that degree of, you know, smashing in the cop car or whatever, it's kind of like, I feel at a certain point, a lot of people feel that they can do it because of what they have, because of maybe the protection they have, because of maybe the money they have. I don't know. But if anything, the horrible part about that, right? The horrible part about putting a TV into a cop car is that at the end of the day, that's probably going to pay off even more because of now all the publicity around it. Mm-hmm. You know, not that I condone that shit, you know, but we're talking the music world, and this is how the music world works, is, mm-hmm. yeah, you can do something real shitty. I mean, you know, if we're going to go even deeper, when's the last time you thought about R. Kelly before all the allegations?
Well, oh, shit. Yeah.
Yeah, that's true.
But it
also goes into, you remember that saying that not all publicity is good publicity? Nowadays, that's, again, like I said before, we're in bizarre world where all publicity is good publicity, whether it's bad shit, good shit, no matter what, as long as it gets the people
talking. And that's crazy.
And
that's crazy. And that's crazy.
To go back just a second.
But you got to walk a fine line, though.
Mm.
To go back just a second, it's funny that when Blood described the TV through the cop car, you thought about established artists and how they might do it and feel safe or protected because of their team or their legal
right,
or their money.
Right.
I thought about independent unsigned artists and how the majority of them would do that shit because they're thinking, oh, this is going to make me go viral. Mm-hmm. And now it's going to pull
world star.
In.
Yeah, world star.
So
yeah.
If the majority of the unsigned artists would do it because they kind of feel they need to.
Right, right, right.
And the majority of the signed artists would do it because they kind of feel they need to. Like, it just goes to show where the music business and society itself is just downward spiraling to where you feel you have to take this extreme negative action. Because, my nigga, you put a TV through a cop car, that there's ramifications.
Oh, you got a problem.
Yeah, absolutely.
But to feel the need to do that to succeed or to spark success, like, yo, that's fucking tragic, bro. I pray for the next generation and shit.
That's a very good point, you know, because talking about the R. Kelly thing or talking about, you know, for example, TV through a cop car, whatever, you know, someone fighting an old man on the street just because.
Yeah, just for the views.
All of that shit is tragic. It's all tragic. You know, I am a firm believer in you get more flies to honey than you do shit. You know what I mean? So I feel that, yes, you can, if you want, not condoning it, but you can take that short route. You can take that real quick clout, you know, but you are going to go real quick. You're going to go quick.
Right.
You will be around for maybe a year or two max. Right. You know,
that's what I'm saying. Like, you got to walk a fine line because it can contribute to your success at the same time to your demise, you know, because it's self-destruction at the same time because, hey, you know, you're built up as this character that does these outlandish things, you know, apart from your music. But there's going to be a point of time that you're going to cross the line and you might not be able to come back from it.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And that's the other part.
Go ahead. Yeah.
That's the other part with things like R. Kelly. It's like, you know, he's a piece of shit person, you know, for doing what he did. And you see how maybe there's that little bump, when that documentary came out in maybe his streams or whatever, but now it's just all decline. Now it's all decline. You know what I mean?
Yeah. He fucked himself over. Yeah. Now he's in jail.
Yeah, I remember.
You know, no time. You know.
To go back to what you were saying, Blood, you were talking about how the negative actions can lead to your success or your downfall. Y'all remember the dude Boonk Gang?
Oh yeah. Uh-huh.
Yes.
So his story is a case of the negative actions leading to the success and the downfall simultaneously. Cause he was for anybody who doesn't know, Boom Gang used to like record videos for the internet, and he would just be doing stupid, outlandish, disrespectful shit, disrespecting people, disrespecting businesses. But at the same time, he was
jumping
up
on people's shit.
He was blowing up. Yeah. But at the same time that the success was coming,
so were the cops.
His spirit was spiraling. He was like, emotionally.
He was struggling with himself.
Energy fucked up. So he ended up having to stop all that shit. He ended up really turning his life around, and I think he became a Christian and or a religious dude. And he actually goes around counseling children now about the dangers of social media and, you know, clout and the addictiveness of all these things that the kids, you know, deal with nowadays. Shout out to him, but I just wanted to point out how both can happen at the same time. And it's such a tough position to be in for not only artists, just people. You know what I mean? Yeah, just regular people looking for clout and looking for this attention. And that goes back to what we were talking about before, Excel offline, where the apps are addictive and the attention is addictive.
Yeah, it's a drug.
Right. So it's like, how do you? So if you get views for whatever reason, you know, someone picks a shitty reason to get views. Now, how do you do it again? Now you got to do what you just did two times.
Right.
And then the next time, four times that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
If in the first video you slap somebody, then you got to punch somebody, then you got to stab somebody,
then you
got to shoot somebody. Then
it's like, crazy.
The escalation.
It's horrible. It's horrible. And so, you know, so I always believed in, you know, I'm very lucky. I'm very lucky to be raised who I was raised by, you know, I always keep my nose clean. I've always, you know, never been into the shit, you know, never. because I enjoy being a good person. I enjoy, you know, watching other people enjoy being good people, you know? And so while my rise may have taken longer than it would have if I did something shitty, I know I'm okay at the end of the day, because what matters most is not my character. What matters most is myself.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
The true, you know,
and
true
so
character. Not the character,
right,
you
because,
portray,
I mean,
you
know
what
can't,
I mean? Your inner character, like.
Right. Absolutely. Because you can't just put a character in jail and then you're at home sleeping. Exactly. No, you go. You go. Yeah. You know what I mean? You go with your character.
Yeah.
You know, so absolutely, you know, I just believe in people being good people, and it's just a shame. But this is how we're wired, because even back when, you know, our parents were watching the news has always been bad news. Always been bad news.
Yeah.
News has always been bad news.
Absolutely.
That's just the way it is, because it sells more.
Exactly.
It sells more.
Exactly.
You know, so it's like, okay, well, now you got everybody wired this way. So you got people doing some shady shit, unfortunately, you know, to get to a certain level. But I don't think they understand the repercussions.
No. This conversation is leading my brain into a the character versus character battle that I can only imagine 99% of the artists are going through, or hopefully less. Hopefully there's a lot more artists with a lot more sense. But when you have to battle your internal character versus the character you're portraying, and they're not the same thing and they don't match, that's probably why a lot of artists are fucked up and you know, they OD or they try to OD.
I was just going to say, that's a recipe for self
destruction. Anyway, let's go to some positive shit. Shout out to all the... Let's go to the TikTok videos, brother. What inspires your TikTok videos? Like, how do you think of this shit?
Bro, usually I just drink like a cup pot of coffee in the morning and I just go off. That's it. It just happens.
Like,
you know, I know everybody. Listen, I know everyone always wants like these deep, meaningful answers, you know, with like artists and everything. And I get it. And I wish I could.
The honest answer is my brain.
My brain just works like that. I don't know. And it's not a brain people should be sought after by any means. It just happens, you know. So like I'll just be out doing something. I'll be out at the park or something and just have this weird idea. You know, this weird video idea. Or like I said, I'll just drink a bunch of coffee and then all of a sudden I have this weird idea. And so I just do it. You know, because here's how I see things, right? I believe in life we got these darts in our hands. You know, like playing the game of darts, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so I feel like we got all these darts in our hands. So you might as well throw every single one and hope that one hits the bullseye.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. That goes back to a conversation that we've had on this show many times. And that is actually one of the advantages of today's society and social media and shit. We live at a time where you can be or attempt to be whatever the fuck you want to be. So if you decide you want to be a photographer, you go get your camera, you start taking some pictures, you put it up online, and boom, now you have a chance to be a photographer. You know what I'm saying? So shout out to that.
Absolutely.
That's one of the positives that we actually looked over and didn't mention. But
right.
The internet and social media has given us these opportunities. Even us, for example, we are not trained media personalities. We didn't go to school for communications
or
and
journalism
radio and shit and journalism. We just decided, let's do a fucking podcast, and we got an engineer and a studio and a camera and some mics, and boom, we're podcasters. So shout out to that aspect.
Fucking dark.
Yeah, throw shout out to
everybody,
that aspect,
throw them
bro.
Darts.
Yeah, definitely listen to the brother Exel. Throw them darts. Every dart you got, throw it and try it, and
everything.
You may be the next fucking Hype Williams. You may be the next whatever, chef, super chef Ramsey or whatever.
Larry King.
Yeah, try anything you fucking have an interest in, and your life will be better, for sure.
Absolutely, because you know what? We are here. Whatever, you know, whatever comes after, whatever people, you know, have for their own belief system, we're here. We're here in this moment. We're here on this earth for a very short period of time.
Yep.
Very short.
Yep.
And we never know when it's up.
Yep.
We never know when it's up. You got cats like Bruce Lee being one of the best players in the world, dying at 32. You know what I mean? So, like, come on, man. You know, so We got a very short amount of time, so you might as well throw whatever you got. I don't care if it's a song, if it's a skit, whatever it is, because there are songs that people have written in 4 minutes that went 10 times platinum. And then there's songs that people have not finished for 5 years. Mm-hmm. You know, so you might as well just throw everything at it, because no one's going to hate you for one bad song. No one's going to hate you for one bad record. Yeah. People just want you to release content. So, you know, moral of that TikTok story is just release content, whatever it may be, whatever idea you have, somebody might find value in that.
Yeah, and you might have the hottest song ever, but if only you hear it, it's not
you would
doing
never
anybody
know.
Any good. Yeah. Yeah, you have to let the people hear it. You have
exactly.
To acting.
Right, you would never know.
Do you think you will ever go into some sort of acting? Or are you
so.
Interested?
Shit.
Do you have any interest in going into acting?
Yeah. Yeah, totally. You know, I have interest in everything, you know, anything within creative space.
Right.
You know, I love music, I love acting, I love comedy, I love modeling, you know, I love all that stuff. Anything creative, like, I just love it.
You could be the stunt double, right? You could try the stunt double thing for
Listen, man, Aquaman 2.
Exactly.
Aquaman 2, Jason's Revenge.
And there you go.
You know? I'm there.
Shit.
I'm there.
Yeah,
you know,
if you never lay up to Lisa Bonet, just let me know, my name. That would be my dream right there. Lisa Bonet right there, you know? Shout out to Jason Momoa.
Man, and you know what? I mean, how dope is it, though? How dope is it, though, that, like, all of them get together? Lenny Kravitz and Jason and Lisa Bonet all get together.
That maturity that they display.
And Zoe people. Kravitz. Oh, Zoe Kravitz.
Shout out to that mature sense.
You know, and people don't talk about Lenny enough. Man, he's always been a great artist. Oh, my God.
Yeah, and that motherfucker don't age. Shout out to Lenny Kravitz.
He's a vampire.
No, yeah, he don't. He don't age.
For real.
Nah, my favorite Lenny Kravitz joint is It's Not Over Till It's Over. I fucking love that song. That's a good one.
You know who I was thinking about the other day that no one talks about anymore?
What you got?
Do you remember Seal? Y'all remember Seal?
Shout out to Seal, man.
The last time I heard of Seal was an old freestyle by Joe Budden, and he says something about what was Seal's wife's name?
Her name is
Claudia.
Heidi Klum. Yes.
No, Heidi
he
Klum.
Says something to the effect of Heidi Klum left Seal, and that just proves that even the ugliest things end, or it just proves that things could get ugly. Some shit. He's making fun of Seal, y'all. I thought it was the funniest bar. But no, damn, I haven't heard of a Seal song. Fuck. Since that Kiss by a Rose on a Grave, I think.
What a fucking hit. That was a hit. That was a hit.
That was on, what was that?
Batman Forever. Yeah,
that was Batman Forever. Yeah.
Damn. I don't think Maxwell gets enough.
Blown up.
Gets enough credit. Damn, what's that for?
Maxwell. Oh, yeah, yeah. Shout out to him.
Love Hang Sweet? Oh,
yeah,
Hang Love Sweet or something like that? His first album.
Shout out to Maxwell.
Yeah. Love Hang Sweet or something like that. Yeah. But, what are you looking at?
Oh, and Heidi Klum left Seal, which only proved my point. Shit can only be ugly for so long. That's the bar.
Damn.
Shit can only be ugly for so long.
Damn, yeah. That's low, Joe Budden. Damn.
Shout out to Joe
Budden. Oh,
damn.
That's rough.
That's so foul, right? But
that's rough.
Yo, when you play with them words, you got to make it, you know, make it right.
Yeah.
Yo, you know, it's like Rory and Mal as well, man. They doing their thing ever since they split up with Joe Budden.
Hell yeah, blood and BS.
Sauce Boys.
Yeah, when we break up, we're gonna have our own show.
Sauce Boys.
Nah, man. Shout out to my co-host, bro. I know I am not the easiest character to deal with, and I often joke of going solo, but y'all my bros. I can't leave y'all.
Aww.
But if y'all got the right check,
that,
the private. Nah, but brother XL, thank you for being here, brother. Tell us about what can we expect next within the next upcoming month. Well, I know you got the new song dropping next month. We're going to see the rollout for that.
Yeah.
And anything else to end out the year? Because we're actually almost through the year, guys. Yo, and quick fact.
I know.
Quick fact, not a black fact, just a regular fact. July was the warmest recorded month in the history of recording months.
Warm months?
Yeah. Nice. So shout out to global warming.
Oh, no, we're fucked. We're all fucked. No. I was reading an article, and all the scientists from the United Nations got together, and they were like basically telling us we have started a chain of events that is irreversible, and we're all fucked.
We are in big trouble, but fuck all that. Think positive.
I don't know why you're listening to science. Everybody knows science isn't real. I don't know. Science is not real. I don't know.
Everyone has an agenda. But what can we expect besides the new song dropping next month that everybody's going to be on the lookout for? What can we expect after that?
Well, first off, let me clarify. That was a joke. I totally believe in science. So, like, I hope nobody comes to me for that one.
Oh, no, no. Whatever your beliefs are, we respect
it. We appreciate sarcasm.
Yeah, hell yeah.
I mean, I guess I respect it. But, like, if someone says, hey, man, climate change ain't real, it's like, bro, I don't know what to tell you.
It's August, and 120.
Like
yeah, but XL, there's people like that, bro. Just ignorant for no reason, and you can show them the data, you can show them the fact, you can show them the fucking iceberg melting, you know, onto their kicks, and they're gonna be like, nah,
that shit ain't real.
Nah, that iceberg is fake.
it's wild, and I learned this yesterday. All right, so I've learned to not talk, and this is another thing for artists. I learned to not talk about my personal views with things. So yesterday, just to kind of wrap everybody in, I had talked about, hey, maybe we should all get the vaccine so we can get back to normal, you know, because there's nothing showing that anybody's died from the vaccine. There's nothing. And when you look at the science, there's nothing.
Right.
So I had posted that on my personal Facebook page. I literally saw my streams on Spotify go down.
Wow.
Per second.
Damn.
And yeah. And so, you know, and that's somebody at an independent level. You know what I mean? So I can only imagine, you know, what it would be
and for someone at a Grammy level. But was there backlash on Facebook? Did you get a lot of like?
Oh God, yeah, yes, absolutely. So I had people say, "Hey, you know, it's been nice, you know, fucking with you and your music, but I'm out." I had people get a hold of me, you know, that were childhood friends. Get a hold of me in my DMs and say, hey, you know, I know we grew up together and everything. We might have not had the best childhood past, but I always look to you as a friend, but I'm going to start unfollowing you for that. So, you know, my thing is
that doesn't make any sense to me, though.
People are not allowed to have opinions. You can agree to disagree and still be friends with a person. It's amazing how little respect people have for other people's opinions. If we're not on the same page, fuck you. I don't want to talk to you. I don't want to follow you. I don't want to listen to your music. I don't want to buy your merch. I don't want to see your face. And it's like, damn, we just don't agree on some shit. Yeah. On some shit that, you know, nobody knows the right answer.
Exactly.
Nobody knows if the vaccine is the right thing. Right. Nobody knows if it's not.
Ain't none of us scientists.
Yeah. We're just following, you know, you follow your intuition and whatever, however you were raised and whatever you've learned, that's going to be that's going to lead you to your decision, whatever it is. But damn, I can't knock somebody because their decision is different. You want to go get the fucking vaccine?
Absolutely.
Get it five times. I don't give a shit. It don't bother me. 1%.
Listen, absolutely. Listen, I got a friend that's, he's a pro-Trump, he's a Trumper, he's anti-vax. And, you know, he's one of the smartest individuals that I know. And, like, I'll hit him up from time to time, like, hey, what's up, motherfucker? And, like, you know, we'll shit on each other back and forth about our beliefs. But just because he feels that way doesn't mean I'm not going to be his friend. I might hit him up to get some information that I wouldn't know otherwise.
Right.
You know, to get his point of view.
Right.
Because sometimes I have to open up my own mind about things, you know? So I don't know. Mm-hmm. These people are just ignorant. You're better off without him, my brother.
But it's crazy that just an expression of opinion
has a ripple effect.
Yeah, this is different from like what the baby did on stage. That was an expression of just ignorance. I'm talking about you're just expressing your opinion.
Yeah.
That it can have such a negative effect on your career, on your, you know,
your well-being.
Yeah, on your, like you said, on your streams and on your fan base, like. That goes back to the character. You can't, you know, you have to stay within that character. whatever it may be.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
No, you got to come in.
Absolutely. So, you know.
Exel, you got to come in as the kick-ass wrestler that don't give a shit. And if you don't agree with me, I'm going to just body slam you.
Yeah, like let me tell you something, brother. Me and you, middle of the ring, steel chairs. You know, man. And I'll tell you what. So, like, with all of this, I am all for anybody's opinion on anything until it becomes hateful. You know, like you just spoke about, like the baby. You know,
exactly.
Sure, freedom. Listen, freedom of speech. Yes, you do have freedom of speech, but you do not have freedom from consequence.
Yep.
You know,
damn, that's a good one.
So, you know, you can say whatever you want. You really can, but understand that there are consequences that come afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
Correct.
Now, you know, with this blanket statement that I had on Facebook about the vaccine, I do not care. I do not care if somebody gets it or if they don't. I do not care because I cannot force somebody, and nor are we ever going to have anybody being held down, you know, getting shots injected into them, because that's just not how America works.
Oh, fingers crossed.
Fingers. I mean, there's definitely been times, don't get me wrong, you know, but, you know, we're hoping that we're above that at this point in time. We're hoping. Mm. So with this whole vaccine thing, you know, I don't care what people do. I don't care what people do. I really don't. But, I mean, you think about it. My point was, in order for me to go to school when I was a kid, I needed all my measles shots. I needed all these different kind of shots in order to be around public, right?
Mm-hmm.
So for me, I do not see the difference between somebody having to get a vaccine to be around public when there's a disease out there. Mm-hmm. I had to do it for measles shots, and I didn't know what was in that vaccine, but I still had to get it, you know? Mm-hmm. So that's where I stood on that. Now, like I said, I got a whole bunch of backlash. It was kind of split 50-50. You know, there was over 100 comments on the post and everything. And my DMs blew up. You know, DMs blew up. People telling me, you know, go fuck myself. They no longer fuck with me anymore. And the only thing I can say is that's okay. That's all right. That's all right. Because I do not hate you for your opinion. Mm-hmm. I do not hate you. I'm still going to be chill with you. If all of y'all on the show right now, you know, said, hey, you know, you're totally wrong about that, I say, okay, that's fine. We're still cool, exactly. You know, because that's the power of opinion.
Right.
That's the power of opinion.
Another example of how this country is so divided and tension.
Because
and
we always negative, look for
that,
it.
That negative that you spoke of earlier, that negative cloud that just seems to be prevalent and non-leaving.
It's because like everybody we always look for it.
Yeah, everybody wants to look for something to argue about or not agree on.
It's a shame. It's a shame, you know, and I do, honestly, you know, I don't usually talk bad about, like, the lockdowns and everything. I think they were worthy, at least the first time around. But here's the thing. I do blame the pandemic for how we are now becoming with everyone's always looking for something to hate, because now Black Lives Matter is no longer a hot button topic. You know what is COVID. So now let's draw the line between vaxxers and non-vaxxers. Mm-hmm. Whereas before it was people drawing a line between Black Lives Matter and all lives matter.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. And social media is right. You know, COVID and social media, they're doing a tag team thing,
mm-hmm.
because now everyone has this platform. So now they want to, you know, let their voice and their opinion be heard. So if Exel posts something, they want to be the one to come back and say, like, no, Exel, you're wrong. The vaccine, whatever, is deadly or whatever the case may be. They want the eyes and the attention to now shift to them and their opinion. So it's like those two things together.
Right.
It's crazy, bro. Lockdown had everybody alone, but social media had them mm-hmm. with everybody at the same time. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
absolutely.
I get what you're saying.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and the effects, the psychological and the emotional effects that we're not going to really even know about for 10 to 20 years. You know what I mean? The PTSD that people are going to have from...
We got PTSD right now.
Right now, so imagine a child. Yeah. Imagine a five-year-old going through this. Imagine a newborn that...
Yeah.
Yo, there's kids out there that didn't experience outside to a year after being born, because they were born into lockdown.
Yeah.
And they would go into sensory overload because they're like, what the fuck is going on here? Exactly. Who are all these people, all these lights and shit?
Man.
I've been in one room for the past year.
And who are these people with masks on?
Yeah,
you know,
imagine,
I mean,
social.
Like, my daughter met her grandparents with masks on.
Yeah.
And they had to wear masks.
Imagine the underdevelopment of social skills.
Right. That's the other thing.
You know, people don't even know how to go outside and be social anymore, because how do you? I don't know if you, do we shake hands? Do we dap it up?
That's a
huge
point.
Yeah.
I don't fucking know.
That's such a good point. There's so much psychology to this. It really is. You know, because I've had people ask me before, you know, now I'm going to be honest, you know, I'm very, I like to date around. You know what I mean? So
shout out to that.
I'm in my 20s.
Hey,
I'm in my 20s.
And XO, you just had the glow up, bro. You got to fucking, like, you know,
bro, I'm finally
reap the
enjoying
benefits.
This shit.
Yeah, reap the benefits, bro.
I'm finally enjoying 26 this
26 years to make up now.
For real.
Yeah. I know. I'm finally enjoying this shit.
Hey, like, have
damn,
fun,
is that
brother,
Jason Roman Reigns? I was like, it can be. It can, if you want me to be Jason or Roman, I'm there. All right.
Enjoy, bro.
But no,
enjoy.
For real. But for real, you know, people have asked me before, like friends of mine, like, you know, how do you? People don't even know how to talk to women anymore. You know, women don't know how to talk to men or whatever they identify as, you know, whatever someone identifies as, don't know how to talk to a person. Mm-hmm. It's wild. Mm-hmm. It's so wild.
It's a new
it
world,
is.
Bro.
It is.
It's
it
a
is.
New
it
world
is.
That we're all getting used
and
to.
And in addition to...
It ain't easy.
In addition to that whole social lockdown, the fact that you know, you can't communicate with people anymore, is that whole... everything's being magnetized too, that whole Me Too movement. You know, which is good and bad at the same time. You know, I say it's more good because these women are finally getting the, you know, the love that they deserve. But at the same time, like, you can't even approach a woman anymore sometimes.
Without fear of getting Me Too'd and shit. Yeah.
Correct.
You know, I saw a post that somebody had on that. Some girl, you know, on my Facebook had asked, you know, why don't guys approach me? And she's a very attractive girl, you know. And a lot of the guys had said that, you know, they had stated that, because, you know, it could be taken a certain way. So I'm kind of on the mindset now. I think a lot of people are on the mindset, I should say, is that if someone's not on a dating app, if you do not match them on a dating app, don't talk to them. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And that's
that,
very
now,
different.
Now you
that's,
just eliminated everything. Anyone, I don't know, 30 and older would know. Because you got to remember, there's people out there, dating apps didn't exist.
Yeah.
You had to go out, you had to meet somebody.
Outside was
the
dating app.
Yeah, you had to speak to somebody face to face or get their attention somehow.
You couldn't even put the phone number in your cell phone. I used to carry around a pen to get phone numbers, write it on my hand.
Don't let your wife hear that.
You know, we're talking about... No, I'm talking about when I was a jit, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, exactly. Make sure you express it.
Yeah, selling out quick.
You know, I mean, but obviously, if there was no cell phone, you couldn't put a phone number in a cell phone. You couldn't even, it was, I'm talking about even pre-beepers, you know what I'm saying? Like, we old school.
The Black
you know,
Book, baby.
Outside,
shout out to the Black Book.
Shout out to the Black Book, word up.
So imagine now, like, how do you compliment a person without sexually harassing the person.
Right.
You know
what
I'm saying? Like, there's such a fine line. That...
You know, I think, now, let me clarify. So I am very for, you know, women's rights and very for, you know, I'm very for the woman. I was raised by a strong woman, you know, so I understand, you know, I think the biggest issue is that you see more and more, right? You see more and more that women are getting... you know, whatever bad thing can happen that you can think of is happening to women from these dating apps. So now the guard is so high. Mm-hmm. Now the guard is so high that even though you, all of us here talking, could be great guys.
Right.
They don't know that.
Exactly.
You know, so now the guard is up against every single man, you know, and you can't, there can't be a fault for that. You know, I know to us, it's like, damn, you know, but I'm this, I'm definitely not that. I get that. But, you know, we have to, this kind of goes along with the respect. It's like, hey, I understand this is how men have been real lately. You know, so for me, if I'm going to approach anybody in public, I look for the signs, You know what I mean? She's playing with her hair. I'm going to be like, hey, what's up? You know what I mean? But if there's no signs, I'm not going to cold call it. You know what I mean?
Right.
And the difficulty that you just described with the women, you know, the dangers that these dating apps put these ladies into. Mm. So their guard is up from that, right? From danger, their guard is up. Mm-hmm. Then their guard is up from COVID.
I believe so.
You know what I mean? Yeah. Their guard has to be up from COVID.
Yeah. Yeah.
Then they're probably a little socially awkward, as we are, as anyone would be after being locked up for a year and not fucking speaking to anybody. So it just makes everything, like, that's already three layers of difficulty that you have to get to even know if this is somebody you want to get to know, because you got to talk to them and then figure out, like, damn, do I even want to continue talking to them?
But exactly. She could be a she could look nice, but could be a complete psychopath.
Tough times. Tough times. But shout out to everybody out there doing their thing.
Okay.
Be safe. Be careful. Mm-hmm. And the brother XL, you have a cheat code, bro, because you're funny. So you just make them laugh and then you in there.
Oh, bro.
Yo, funny guys.
I had someone tell me once, I was talking to this kind of like a promotion thing, you know, to help get the music out there more. And they had called me, and like, this was the most offhanded compliment I ever got in my life. They had said to me, they were like, listen, you know, you got the whole package, you know, you're this, and you're also good looking and you're funny, which you don't see a lot of that. And I was like, what the hell? What do you mean?
Well, it's like you said, growing up, if you're good looking, you don't have to be funny because the eyes are already on you because you're good looking. But if you grow up and you're not great looking, you develop the character, the personality, the way to talk to people. And then when the glow up happens, you're the total package.
Oh, forget it, man.
You're Lex Luger.
You're winning.
Hey, listen, there definitely is. I totally believe in good-looking people that have been good-looking their whole life. Let me clarify. They have a privilege. They are privileged, you know, because I see people on, like, Tinder and stuff. They ain't even got a bio. They just got good-looking pictures, and they think that's enough. No, sweetie.
They've never had to develop beyond that.
Exactly. They would just, this is me. Take it. You know, I may be beautiful, but I have no personality.
But
it's wild. It's seriously so wild, you know. I mean, that was just an offhanded compliment. I mean, I took it, but it's like, damn. Thanks, I guess.
Funny guys stay winning, bro. Let me tell you.
Before, not to get too much into your personal XL, but you said you're dating around, so that would mean you're single, yes?
Yeah.
All right. So all the ladies looking for a good-looking brother, Jason Momoa type, Roman Reigns type. Mm-hmm. He'll dress up like Roman a wrestler Reigns for you. Son. He'll make you laugh. He'll body slam you.
He'll put you in a comic mask. Book if you want.
I'll wear the cane mask.
He'll wear the Aquaman tights.
Fire role-playing. Fire coming out of the bedpost. Fire coming out of the bedpost.
Role-playing.
Follow at XL the King for all that good stuff.
Yeah, man.
And OnlyFans.
Roll the eyes back like the other paper.
Oh man, let's get into a segment, brother. It's called 10 Shots with VSOP. The brother VSOP is going to ask you 10 rapid fire questions. Don't think about them. Answer them, and then we'll circle back to get to them.
Yeah, like the brother just said, you know, 10 real quick questions. You answer off the top. They're based on either today's episode or past episodes. Like I said, we'll circle back when we're done. All right, so here we go. 10 shots. Since you're into wrestling, and so is our co-host over here, you know what I'm saying? Number 10, in your opinion, who's the better wrestler, Kane or The Undertaker?
Ooh.
Undertaker. All right. We'll go with that. Number 9, this is hip-hop oriented. I know you listen to older hip-hop. Who you like better, Kane or Rakim?
Rakim.
Okay. Best era in hip hop, in your opinion, 80s, 90s, or 2000s?
90s.
Cool. If somebody had to make you choose between the two, which one would you take, music or acting?
Music.
All right. Better producer, in your opinion, the RZA or Primo?
Oh, Riz.
The RZA. Good answer. All right. Number 5, Big L or Big Pun, in your opinion, who's a better rapper?
Ooh. Pun.
Pun. All right. Number four, Lauryn Hill or Mary J? Your opinion, better artist.
Lauryn Hill.
Lauryn Hill. Nice.
Lauryn Hill.
Cool, cool, cool. Number three, is Jada top five dead or alive?
Say that again. You cut out.
Is Jada Kiss top five dead or alive?
Mm-hmm. Ooh. Live.
What was that? He's not?
Alive. Yes.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Cool.
He
cool.
is top five. Okay.
Number, what are we up to? Number two? Number two. Wu-Tang or Mobb Deep?
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. That's Wu-Tang. Wu-Tang.
All right, all right. And the one that started it all for the Godcast, who's the best MC, Biggie, Jay-Z, or Nas?
Oh, my God. I got to go Biggie. I got to go Biggie.
There you have it, ladies and gentlemen.
All good answers.
Yeah. Our co-host that isn't here, the brother Black, he would be proud of you for choosing Biggie.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, they should be.
Definitely. Man, no listen, answer, mom's bro. From New York, so you know.
Exactly.
Mom's from New York, so I got to rep Biggie.
Absolutely.
Awesome.
Absolutely. Awesome. Shout out to Lauryn Hill. Okay. She got a new verse on the new Nas album, King's Disease 2. That is out now. Make sure y'all go stream that.
On the song Nobody, man. She kills it.
Yeah,
you heard it? You finally heard it?
Oh, yes.
Dope. Okay.
Shout out to Pun. Rest in peace, Pun, as always. Shout out to the RZA, as always. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you guys are aware. Shout out to DJ Premier. He recently linked up with Mass Appeal, and he now has a new show on YouTube, I believe, where he kind of breaks down little 2-minute videos.
Oh yeah, yeah, I did see
him
that.
Breaking down like songs that he's produced. I saw.
Oh,
he did. Come Clean.
He broke down the Biggie Unbelievable.
Come Clean was the
right?
First inaugural episode, and yeah. Biggie's Unbelievable was the second episode. So make sure y'all check that out. So
yeah,
DJ Premier. And yeah, bro, brother Exel, thank
we
you.
We might get that Nas Primo album. We might get that Nas Primo album.
Yeah, featuring Cormega, bro. It's gonna come out.
Okay. I'll take that.
The brother Exel, thank you for being on the show, brother. Everybody, make sure you're following at Exel the King on all the social media and on YouTube. Make sure you check out his songs.
Right.
Home Run, Orange, Good. He's got a new song dropping next month. Make
go watch
sure
that good video.
Be on the lookout for the merch coming. Make sure you watch the good video. Make sure you be on the lookout for the new video coming soon. Mm-hmm. And hopefully, if we don't go into lockdown, the brother Exel will be out there performing, hitting the road, touring.
Touching the fans. Pause.
Make sure you keep us in the loop, Exel, with anything you got going on. Share it
of
with
course.
Us. We'll share it with everyone out there.
Mm-hmm.
And much success to you, brother. Thank
yeah,
you for
man,
being
much,
on the show.
Much success to you, my brother.
Yeah, I appreciate this. It's really, man. Truly, truly been a blessing to be here today. Thank you all so much, no, you know, man. For the love, for the support.
Definitely. For sure.
You know, I mean, this is incredible, you know, to come together with like-minded people. This is always incredible.
Absolutely. And you'll be back, brother. I know that for a fact. We'll definitely have you up here again. Don't hang up, though. Don't disconnect.
Of course, I'd be honored.
Don't disconnect. Let's very quickly get into the M. Burnz Love Song of the Week. So every week I select a song that I love for whatever reason that week. For this week, I'm going to go with an obvious choice. This is the brother Nas. This is a song called Daughters. Let's give shout-outs to Tiana.
Okay.
Tiana Michelle in the building. Let's give a shout-out to Siomara. Let's give a shout-out to Zamina. Let's give a shout-out to Aaliyah. Let's give a shout-out to Amina. Let's give a shout-out to Adi. Let's give a shout-out to Envy. Let's give a shout-out to Ashley and Mackenzie. All the Breath Babies. All the dude Breath Babies, too. I did not forget about y'all. Baby Xavier. CJ.
Not saying that I sound that less important. Word up.
Exactly. Not at all. Not at all. Nas, Daughters, the love song of the week. Blast that off for us, brother. And shout-out.
Baby girl, Naya.
Yeah. Check it out. I call it. Yeah.
Shout out to all the daughters. Yeah. Shout out to all the fathers. Shout out to all the mothers.
Yeah. For my brothers with daughters, I call this. For my brothers with daughters, I call this.
for my brothers with daughters. I call it
girl dads, girl dads.
I saw my daughter send a letter
to some boy her age who locked up. First I regretted it, then caught my rage. Like, how could I not protect her from this awful phase? Never try to hide who I was. She was taught and raised like a princess. But while I'm on stage, I can't leave her defenseless. Plus, she seen me switching women, poppers on some pimp shit. She heard stories of her daddy thugging. So if her husband is a gangster, can't be mad, I love him. Never for her, I want better. Homie in jail, dead dad. Wait till he come home, you can see where his head's at. Niggas got game, they be trying to live. He seen your mama crib, plus I'm sure he know who your father is. Although you real, plus an honest kid. Don't think I'm slow, I know you probably had that chronic lid. You 17, I got a problem with it. She look at me like I'm not the cleanest father figure, but she rocking with it.
For my brothers with daughters, I call it.
My brothers
with daughters. Shout out Tiana Michelle. Shout out Ziomara. Shout out Zamina. Baby girl Aaliyah. Anaya. Adi. Ashley. Envy. Mackenzie. All the breath babies. Anybody with a daughter. All the young daughters. Shout out to y'all. Love. Woo. Motherfucking Nas, bro. Never fails, y'all.
Mm-hmm.
Once again, shout out to the brother Exel the King. Thank you for being on the show. Everybody, make sure you're following him.
Man,
shout out to the good people at Raised by Latinos. Shout out to the brother Mesa at Mr. 100 Summers. Shout out to the brother Petey at the Digital Food Truck. Shout out to the brother Sammy at Timeless underscore Product. Shout out and happy birthday to YP Music Live, Young Paul, and Boricua 510. And shout out to Neighborhood White Mike and to my co-host. Y'all got any sign-offs? Wait, before you do that, one last shout out.
What you got?
Shout out to the motherfucking glow up.
Okay. That's right.
Oh, man.
That's right.
I don't know when these, listen, man, I don't know what happened, but these Samoan jeans just came in eventually.
Hey, they kick in at 27 or 26, they said. That's when they
got I know, you know. Kind of had to climb the family tree a little bit higher. We got there.
Exactly, brother. But thank God we did. And we're just going to keep going higher and higher for sure.
We're just going to keep going higher. Eventually, I'm going to look like Dwayne The Rock Johnson at 53.
Yeah. Yeah.
For sure, man. For sure. Hey, man. Yeah, man. Not much love and success to you, my brother. You know what it is. LBE.
Thank you.
You know what I mean? BS to the OP, LBE, MDMA all day. We here, man. Godcast.
Absolutely. Bloodshot.
Appreciate it. Really do appreciate this.
Thank you, brother.
Wear it up. Shout out to y'all, man. You already know another dope show. Shout out to the bro XL. I had a fucking blast. Shout out to my favorite wrestler growing up, man. RIP to the Flying Hawaiian Jimmy Flash Snucker.
Oh, hell yeah.
Wow, yeah.
Rest in peace, bro.
Where the and everybody go check out that single Good, man. That's a dope ass track, man.
Right,
absolutely.
Shout out to the boys. Word up. You know how we do.
Yes, the single and the video Good, both out on YouTube. Everybody make sure you check that out. Once again, shout out XL the King. Shout out my co-host. Shout out Brother F, Straight Flavor. Shout out all the girl dads. Shout out to all the breath babies, the breath wives, the breath moms, and the breath dads. As always, y'all, chin up, chest out, carry yourself with honor, carry yourself with pride. This has been episode 76 of the Great American Hip Hop Debate Podcast. I am the brother Burnz, and somebody hit my music.
motherfucker.